To worship.
Morning. Morning, Megan.
Good morning. Welcome to First Church, where you're important, loved, and wanted. So today, I'm going to pass it off to Mike because the Spirit has filled him and just moved him to speak about this next song that we're going to sing called Rescue. So take it away.
I remember the words of the accuser. Your fear is strong. We can use this. Your brothers and sisters will hurt you, so attack first. They will use the sword of tongues to weaken you, so draw yours without reason. In my fear, I replied, where else can I go? My heart pleads, stop, no more, please. Again, I attack. My arms are heavy. I fall to my knees. I took a drink of living water, and now I see. He tells me, you are redeemed. I love you no matter what. Praise God, I need you, Jesus. Where else can I go? Hallelujah, where else can I go?
Amen.
Where else can I go? There's no one. follow you.
This world has nothing for me.
Stars and you call them by name. The skies proclaim, God, you reign. Your glory shines. You teach the sun when to bring a new day. Creation sings, God, you reign. God, you reign. God, you reign. Forever and ever. God, you reign. You You move the mountains with the words that you say. My song remains, God, you reign. You hold my life. You know my heart and you call me by name. I live to say, God, you reign. God, you reign. God, you reign. Forever and ever. God, you
That spirit of surrender. This is that time for us to open up the garden of prayer. Come to these altars, to these front steps, to these chairs, and just surrender. Give it all to you, God. We give it all to you. So just come as we sing.
Christ the Lord is risen to
Raise your joys up.
Dear Lord, we just come to you today. We thank you for your presence here. We thank you for being with us today and every day of this past week and of this coming week. And we just ask you, Lord, we've been singing about rescuing, and we just pray that you will rescue us. We pray that you will rescue us from the troubles that we seem to be carrying that are just too heavy for us to carry. We just fall at your knees, Lord, and we just ask for your grace. We ask for your forgiveness, Lord, for our sins. And we ask that you will just be with us through this coming week. Give us the strength that we need to get through the trials and through the things that are going to come our way. Help us to understand the results that we may get from health tests, or help us get through things that we're doing either at school or at work, or the challenges that we face. But Lord, we also want to be able to sing your praises and to sing Hosanna. We just praise you and thank you for the many blessings that you have given us. And may we take the time, Lord, to really see each of those blessings, even in the midst of these challenges and in the midst of these trials. Even if we have addictions, or even if we have troubles, or even if we're trying to find a job, we just thank you that we can pray to you in this nation, Lord, that we can call out your name and that you will hear us. The King of Kings and the Lord of Lords will hear a lowly sinner like ourselves and just hear our prayers and know that you are there to bring us peace, to bring us comfort, to bring us guidance for each and every thing that we are going through, Lord. You know the prayers in the hearts of these people who are here today. They have come before you, Lord. They are humbling themselves at the foot of your cross. And we pray that you will bless each and every one of them, and that you will give them your presence. Give them the joy that they need in their heart of you and your love. And may people see Jesus in each of us as we go out into our days. And each of these people who are here, may you bless them and keep them, Lord. And we thank you for your presence today. In Jesus' name, amen.
For we know where Christ has led.
How are you all feeling? All right. A round of applause for yourselves. You look great today. So let's have everybody stand. Get some blood flowing. Everybody stand. Get some blood flowing. We're going to greet each other. It's moments of hospitality. I know this is your favorite time. So please make sure that you greet each other and say hello to someone you may not know as well. Thank you. Thank you.
slow today. I'm slow.
Hey, at least you're singing around.
Thank you. Sorry. You never know. If you'd return to your seats, we'll continue. Rose Guido is going to sing for us.
Good morning, church. Can everybody hear me? Can you hear me now? All right. Thank you. I'm going to sing Joy Comes in the Morning. This is a rendition by Martha Borg. I don't know if anyone's familiar with her. But I'm going to try to do it some justice this morning. Tears often fall on my face in sorrow as I walk on through the long, lonely night. Often I cry, but it seems no one hears me. Then through the shadows I can see the dawning of light. Oh, soon this life, with all of its trials, will be left behind. There's a new day, a dawn. Shadows of sin will vanish forever. He promised me there's gonna be joy in the morning. tears cannot stain the pathway of glory. No broken heart will find up there beyond the sky. My mansion's awaiting by the light of the morning. We'll sing the songs of sweet victory. Oh, soon this old life with all of its trials will be left behind. There's a new day of dawning. The shadows of sin will vanish forever. He promised me there's gonna be joy in the morning. Shadows of sin will vanish forever. He promised me there's gonna be joy in the morning. Hold on, my child. Only last for the night. Hold on, my child. Joy comes in the morning. The darkest hour means dawn is just inside. Hold on, my child. Joy comes in the morning. Oh, weeping only lasts for the night. Hold on, my child. Darkest hour means dawn is just in sight.
Thank you, Rose. All right, if we have children here, we're going to dismiss them now. They're going to Kids Connection. They're going to follow this lady here. There you go. Thank you, Manny. Mm. How you doing? You look good. Look good from this side. I don't know. You know. See if I can get situated here. It's always complicated. Last week, I began speaking to you about grace. God's grace. Do you remember that? Please say yes. Please, yes. Okay. And I spoke to you particularly about God's saving grace. We talked about that. And there were individuals that came forward and received that saving grace last week. And we are grateful. This week, I want to speak to you about guilt and grace. Guilt and grace. Let's talk about it. There was an article in the newspaper. I don't know which newspaper. Where two men were standing trial for armed robbery. An eyewitness takes the stand, and the prosecutor begins his questions of the eyewitness. He says, "You were at the scene of the robbery?" And the eyewitness says, "Yes." "You saw a vehicle leave at a high rate of speed?" Eyewitness says, "Yes." "Did you observe the occupants?" Eyewitness says, "Yes." And in a big, booming prosecutorial voice, he asks, "Are those two men in this courtroom today?" And at this point, the defendants sealed their own fate because they both raised their hands. So we're talking about guilt today. And the truth is that all of us, at some point in our lives, have to honestly say, "I did it. I did it." We're all in that same boat, you know. I did it. Recognizing the fact that whether it's one sin or many sins in our lives, we've all slipped up at some point. Thank you, Stacy. Appreciate that. There you go. You may get the whole sermon. Okay. So let's deal with this together, shall we? Let's talk about this. And let's recognize that God has an answer to this. What is it that real guilt is? What's the difference between real guilt and another kind of guilt? A false kind of guilt. Our way of dealing with guilt is much different than God's way of dealing with guilt. So the first question is, what is guilt? We all know what it feels like, don't we? Don't we? Yes, you do. This verse in the Bible reminds us of what it feels like. So let's read it together. It's from Psalms, the 38th chapter and the 4th verse. Let's read it together. It says, "My guilt has overwhelmed me like a burden too heavy to bear." Oh, yeah. That's exactly how it feels, isn't it? It overwhelms us. Every one of us knows that overwhelmed, burdened feeling, that feeling that says to us, "I hope nobody ever finds out." That feeling. But is that all there is to guilt? Is that what God means it to be? No, it's not. The purpose of guilt is not just to make you feel bad. Guilt is a warning light. A warning light. It's a warning light that goes on and says, something's wrong, something needs to be fixed. Danger, danger, Will Robinson. You remember that? Mm-hmm. It's like the warning light that comes on your dashboard, on your car, which says something is wrong. What do you do when that warning light comes on? We're going to talk about that. Now, the question is, does it help to go ahead and break the warning light on the dashboard so it's not annoying you anymore? Does it help to do that? No. It's saying that something needs to be fixed. And when this guilt warning light comes on in your life, it's saying you need some time with God. That's what it says. Okay? You need God to heal this. So before we look at the difference between of how we try to deal with that warning light and how God's able to deal with it, how we try to fix ourselves and how He's able to fix us, we've got to make a very important distinction in all of this. So, in the first place, there are two kinds of guilt. There's genuine guilt, you know, the real deal. The genuine guilt that comes from the fact that I've done wrong things that have hurt me and have hurt others and have hurt the heart of God. That's genuine guilt, you know. Unless we're perfect, and in spite of what some of you think, none of us are. Okay. We've all have to deal with this real kind of guilt, the genuine guilt. We have to get past this and find God's grace in the middle of it. And then there's the other kind of guilt, and we have this too. It's false guilt. False guilt. That's the thinking that maybe there might be a light on the dashboard that comes on and you're so worried about it that you worry yourself into guilt. That's a feeling like if a light on the dashboard ever came on, what would other people think of me? A lot of people deal with this over and over. I've had people say to me something like this: I just have this overwhelming feeling of guilt. I don't know where it comes from. I can't really put my finger on it. I don't know the source of it. I just feel bad about it. Does that sound familiar? Yeah, well, I think so. If you're dealing with false guilt, you're probably sending yourself a lot of mental email along the lines of this, which is you're saying to yourself, you think that's enough? You call that acceptable? Look at all the things you haven't gotten finished. You've disappointed people that are around you. What's the matter with you? You know, that sort of self-talk. For those of you that were sleeping, that is our wake-up call. We do not know where it comes from. We just know that it occurs occasionally. Kind of like being struck by lightning, you know. But if those kind of things you're saying to yourself, if that's the kind of thing you're hearing a lot, then you are dealing with false guilt, that kind of self-talk. Most of the time, those who struggle with this is struggling with incidents that may not have been your fault, for instance. Caught up in a circle of someone else's sin, even your parents, perhaps, or a friend, or physical or mental or emotional abuse. It's all there, see. But it is false guilt. Another source of guilt, another source of false guilt, is you just can't get past your past. You know, I've asked God 1,000 times to forgive me, and I just can't feel forgiven. You can't get past your past. Now, I have to tell you, false guilt is very prevalent among churchgoers. Yes. Mm-hmm. But it produces a faith that is more like walls in our lives than it is like doors in our lives. Interestingly, Paul, the apostle, talks to some people in the book of Galatians who are struggling with false guilt. It's in the Bible, see? People trying to make themselves feel better by doing a lot of good things. It's in Galatians 3:3. I want you to read this with me. You began your life in Christ by the Spirit. Now are you trying to make it complete by your own power? That is foolish. You began your life in Christ by the Spirit, by your faith. But now you're trying to make yourself feel better by your own power. And he's telling us it will not work. You cannot feel forgiven by God, so we try more and more to make it better by our own good deeds and our own power. Positive thinking, all of that. How do I tell the difference? Well, I ask myself questions. Here's a couple of questions I ask myself. Is my focus on people, on judgments, suggestions of others, people that are making me feel this way, or is it on God? Is my focus vague? Vague, foggy feeling of guilt. Do you know what I'm talking about? You have that? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Or is there something specific? Am I focused on rules, such as I broke the rules? Or is it relationships? I hurt someone. Whatever kind of guilt that we're dealing with, true guilt and false guilt, whichever one it is, we've got ways of dealing with it. And God's got ways of dealing with it. You're not alone, in other words, in dealing with this. First, we take a look at our way of handling this kind of guilt. We go back to the light on the dashboard. I had a car once. It was a foreign car, and it was old. And what do you do when the warning light on the dashboard comes on? Well, I put a piece of duct tape over it. Because it was annoying me, you know. And it bothered me, and I worried about it. So I used the old theory, out of sight, out of mind, and I covered it up. It all goes back to the way the first man and the first woman and the first sin. The way they dealt with that first sin. That's pretty common today. Genesis 3 tells us that when they had sinned, they then sewed fig leaves together to cover themselves. And then, what did they do? They hid from God in the bushes. See? And when they were challenged, Adam said, they sewed fig leaves together and made something to cover themselves. And they hid from the Lord God. And he said to God, I was afraid. I was afraid because I was naked. And she gave me fruit from the tree, so I ate it. Oh, way to go, Adam. Mm-hmm. Three ways that are indicated in the way they responded and the way we respond today, because we're all a part of the same human family. We often respond with shame. We often do that. We feel badly about it. Unfortunately, shame doesn't work. See? It says they sewed fig leaves together and they tried hiding. They hid in the bushes from God. It's like putting duct tape over the light on the dashboard. See? Pretending that nothing is really wrong. Next, these two, they tried blame. We like that one. Very popular approach, blame. It's a sad, funny thing that happens in Genesis. We've got Adam and Eve and the serpent standing there. And God comes and asks Adam, "Did you eat of the fruit of that tree that you were forbidden to eat from?" And Adam takes it like a man and blames Eve. See? He points right to her and he says, "She did it. It's her fault. She gave me the fruit." So Eve's standing there, and she blames someone else. She points at the serpent, and she says, "The serpent did it." And of course, the serpent didn't have a leg to stand on. It's easy, and it's almost automatic for us to try to blame your way out of the wrong things that have happened. So we ask the question, what happened? Well, I've got this long list of things, long list of people. God has a way of dealing with guilt, too, and very different from our ways. God's way of handling guilt is found in one of the verses of the Bible that I was taught myself about how to live this new life that God was giving me. And it was 1 John 1:9. Many of you know it. See? Let's read it together. "If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness." 1 John 1:9. That's how we deal with the guilt that makes us miserable. Let's take a look at this. Number one. The verse says, if we confess our sins. So the first thing that you need to do is you need to confess your sin. You say, "God, I did it. I confess my sin." It's not just our need. It's not just frustration and problems. It's our sin. We didn't rely on Him. That's our sin. So what is sin anyway? Well, there's a lot of fancy definitions and books have been written about it. But the easiest way for me to understand it is for me to look at the middle letter in the word sin. S-I-N. Sin is all about I. It's about me. It's about me saying to God,